Brian, but let's get.
I can go for him.
Okay, welcome to the Planning Board meeting for Monday, March 27th, 2017. We're expecting Brian Karp very shortly. But we are missing a couple of members. First of all, I'd like to thank HCAM for taping the meeting today. And you haven't missed anything, Brian?
Just a thank you to
HCAM. Yes, and...
and that you were missing.
Yes. And...
I'm present.
Yep. So anyway, we'd like to thank HCAM for their taping the meeting today. The agenda today, we have two public hearings and a minor revision to the site plan for the Marathon Elementary School. Those are the headliners for it. We also have a get together with Eversource at 8:30 to talk about their particular upcoming projects. We've got a few other things to do as far as regular business. I'd like to make sure that everyone has their invitation for the 6th of April, 9:30 a.m., corner of Legacy Farms Road North and Franklin Road. This is the ribbon cutting in the opening of the Legacy Farms Road North roadway. Everyone in town is invited, particularly all those that were part of the community that attended one of the many or many of the meetings in that whole approval process are invited to help cut the ribbon. We ask that everyone bring their own pair of scissors because we're hoping that we'll have a lot of ribbon cutters. The next meeting is going to be different than normal. First of all, it's on Wednesday. This is April 12th. And second of all, it is at HCAM Studios. So it's different location, different date. We changed it from our normal Monday to accommodate the Passover holiday. And that is going to be a public hearing on the Wayland Chamberlain. We expect a full house. And therefore, we accommodate more space in the HCAM Theater. Okay. So we have two items to start off with a public hearing. I'd like to reopen the public hearing for the proposed zoning bylaw amendment for utility structures. This is a bylaw that the planning board proposed. Zach came through with a recommendation on it. We have another letter today that's at your table from the town council. And so we have that. We're probably talking would be the words that he would be talking at the end if we wanted to go forward with it. It would be on this last page, I believe.
This was emailed to you earlier when I first received it too. Friday or Thursday last week.
Okay. Is there anyone from the public that wanted to talk about that particular one? This is one that's kind of in the weeds, unless you're a utility, I would think. The essence of this particular bylaw is that it would allow a public utility structure to be built under special permit by the Board of Appeals. As opposed to necessarily going all the way to the DPU to get an exemption from that. This would allow these types of structures under special permit to be placed in places in town. The theory is that when we go to the DPU, we get almost no conditions, but it takes them a long time to get it. This would be a substantially shorter process and probably less costly process, and maybe some of those savings would go into landscape or other things that would make it more compatible with what the neighborhood would be looking for. So that is the logic behind this one. But I see no public comment. Are there questions from the planning board members? Yeah.
I guess more of a comment. The way I saw it previous to our update from our town council, it would give us more power over, more choice over, more control of what actually gets done. But after reading his, and just sitting down and reading these comments now, I wish we had a little earlier, it looks like that they could still go to the DPU anyhow, most likely would, in his opinion. And then there's questions that we should consider that I don't see us being able to consider them without reading more up about them tonight. And then he comes back with his comments at the end saying, this is, if you want to pass it, this is what he suggests. But I'm, what really sticks with me the most is that we may not have time to really understand it unless we read it and go through it and ask him any questions, because I have questions I don't know that we can have answered here with his opinion. So I'm thinking maybe as a function we should just table this for...
I'm not so sure that you aren't onto something there, Frank. I mean, we have the requirement to do the public hearing, and then after that, I think for certainly... I'm not for voting tonight on whether we go forward with it at this point. I think there are a lot of questions, and I agree that getting this relatively late in front of us, that maybe we ought to ponder a little bit.
I would agree with that, Mr. Chairman, if I may.
Yeah. Go ahead.
It will almost maybe behoove us to, if Ray's available, to out some of these things off of them, because there are a number of, I want to say conditions, but examples that he states in here. I think at the end of the day, to Frank's point, we could put everything under the sun. They could still just go to DPU and get their approval without condition.
Right. They still can do that, and, you know, that might be the preferred way to do it for them, but it certainly wouldn't necessarily be the preferred way for the residents.
No, but maybe it may give them an option, yeah. Right? And you know, what's in their best interest, hopefully aligns with what our best interest is, and yeah. Meeting the mind.
That was the concept proposed behind it. But whether we've got the words right is one thing, and two, whether it's worth continuing, I don't know. So seeing no public input, are there other questions from the board members? And if not, why don't I suggest that we close the public hearing?
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Any further discussion on closing the public hearing? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. Okay.
Point, Mr.
Yeah.
Point of clarification. In terms of next steps, maybe wasn't very new what are we have to noodle on it at the next meeting and have it as an agenda item, or were there...
I think we'll try to put it on the agenda and get further clarification from Ray.
That's right.
It, in many ways, if we go to, if the utility goes to DPU portion, then Ray's firm also usually gets engaged. Anyway, we'll have to sort that one out too.
Fair enough.
Okay.
So this is being tabled, Mr. Chair?
Yes.
Okay, thank you.
Yep. Okay, the second one is continued public hearing for 74 Main Street, which is a minor site plan. This is the one that we all heard. This is the parking lot in front of the police station. We left it with David that if there was no changes to the plan, we said that he didn't have to show up, and he took advantage of that today. Since we last met on this subject, they have gone to the ZBA. They have gotten their needed It was what?
A variance.
Variance, yes. So, and I believe the variance condition only had one other condition that was a little different in that they want the parking to be identified as public parking, which is in line with our discussions of the time, too. So, I wanted to make sure that our hearing notice took, or our hearing minutes takes note of that effect, that the planning board is not at odds with the ZBA over requiring a public parking sign on the public parking spaces. So, I think we cashed this one well. We were out through the whole outlining it last meeting, and I think we were ready to vote to approve it. And I'd entertain a motion to determine that the plan complies with the site plan standards.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. And then the second motion is on page 4 of Jen's memo. We have the five conditions that we discussed with the applicant. One has to do with snow. Another one is mitigating construction impacts. Another one is removing trash and debris. The fourth one is if the Director of Municipal Inspections needs a professional engineer, we'll provide it. And then the fifth one says that construction can only occur during those times that the town bylaw allows that to do. So, we discussed this conditions. I think at this point, a motion to approve the site plan with conditions is in order.
So moved.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Entertain a motion to close the public hearing.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, we're moving right along. We've got, we did two public hearings in 12 minutes. I think I commend the board members on that one. Okay. Okay. Let's get the school folks here. Then we can go to school.
Which would be Marathon School, right?
Yes.
I know, but they still call it Center School or New Center School.
Just the meet. Marathon and Marathon School.
Me. Or mess.
School.
One.
Come on up.
Super school.
How are we doing?
Great. We're in a good mood today. So,
okay.
So that we just did two public hearings in 12 minutes, which is a record for this board.
Judge, you still need this?
I don't think so. I think we can just do it with the handout. I figure it would take too long to load up the PowerPoint presentation and all that. So I do have a handout here.
Okay. This for board members, this is a minor modifications to the already approved site plan. This is for the Marathon Elementary School.
That's it.
That we approved a while back. And this is for the modifications that were approved by town meeting. The first order of business is for us to determine that it is a minor modifications to a site plan. And Jennifer, you had some rationale for that, and that.
Sure. I felt from a planning perspective that the board had already reviewed the site plan that showed the potential for the expansion. Had approved that with the potential for the expansion, and this is just sort of implementing that expansion at this point. So the board has already somewhat discussed an expansion when they did their original approval. So in my opinion, from a planning perspective, this would be a minor modification in that regard.
Does anyone disagree with where she's coming on this minor? I see none.
I mostly agree. I do want to point out and say that, yes, we've planned it, and it's ready to go in our deliberations. It's already been debated, but it is a pretty large expansion at the same point. So, I don't know, it's like maybe to just discuss it a little bit.
Okay.
I can ask a question through the chair.
Sure, go ahead. We're going to talk about the impacts and the presentation.
I'll wait till after
this.
Okay.
Is the real difference is if we do it as vote as it's a minor, they're done tonight. We can vote on it. We're all set. If not, if we were to determine that it was a major addition, then it would have to get re-advertised and all that other things. And I felt that the issues that we're talking about, one, probably parking and stormwater, were kind of the only two major ones that really got impacted by the impervious surface. Mm-hmm. And I thought, my own opinion, it was also minor. So I felt we could handle it this way. But we will talk about those two issues and any other ones that the board members have tonight to talk about it.
Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, so I have a question on major versus minor. You identified 2 points. Is there a tipping point somewhere that would kind of create a major?
No, under site plan review, once a plan has been filed, any modifications, it would be the board's discretion whether or not it's major versus minor.
Okay. So I would defer to the chairman on that in terms of looking at it as a minor.
Okay. So I'd entertain a motion to consider this a minor modification to an approved site plan.
So moved. Second.
Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. So now we're going on a minor site plan, and please make your application or make your presentation.
Okay.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Tonight we have Tim Bonfadi, President of Compass Management, Judge Christopher from DRA.
We'll
lead the presentation. Thanks.
Okay, Joe.
So thank you for allowing us to come back in on this, the minor modification. So I think many of you may know we're here because our original design enrollment of 355, or 395 actually, when the MSBA gave us an increase, we found that this year the enrollment was 450 when the certification came in. So the demographics that have been done indicate that enrollment is going to go to 480 in the next few years. And by then, it'll sort of stabilize and be consistent from then on, or at least for the demographic planning horizon. This news came to us at the end of the year when they got in all their information on enrollments. And we were able to react quickly enough, at least in the project, that we could develop an expansion program that Judd's going to go over with you, that without impacting the schedule, that we're being able to do it inside the current project schedule. It was kind of a unique confluence of events that allowed us to get the MSBA to buy into it, organize the trades properly to be able to do it, obviously come to town meeting to approve the additional funding that we needed to do it, and basically, continue on with the project essentially as planned with this extension that you'll be seeing soon. We are currently at a point in the project where the trades that have been let, which is we started steel erection in the last week, are now mobilized to build out the extension. We're still in the process of sort of organizing the final costs on it from the contractor, from the construction manager, Colantonio. But we're pretty comfortable that everything's going to come in. Well, we're very comfortable everything's going to kind of come in line with what the budgets we've presented to the town. So with that, you know, our goal is to continue on, obviously, without a you know, kind of keep the momentum going. And we're here to talk to you and answer your questions related to that as we seek this minor amendment. So with that, I'm going to turn it over to you, Judd.
Okay, great. Thanks, Tim. So in the packet that I've handed out, I've tried to boil down the main issues of what is entailed from the classroom expansion into a handful of images and information. The first, after the cover sheet, the first plan, that's the actual site plan that we submitted back last summer as part of the site plan approval through this board. It shows, you know, the classroom with the parking and the driving layouts as we currently have. As you'll note, there was a little couple of little orange boxes off to the left of the main classroom wing identified as a classroom expansion. If you go to the next sheet, that shows
just for, that's just for planning purposes. We do on every project to find some if in the
yes.
future you need an addition. It wasn't related to this expansion.
Yeah, I think it's actually even a requirement by the MSBA.
Right,
correct?
It is. Yeah.
So if you see, the next sheet actually shows what the new plan would envision. It's basically going to take up half of that proposed expansion class expansion area. Primarily what we're adding is four classrooms, two on the lower level and two on the upper level. We're going to kind of stretch the last classroom and the stair wing out so that the building ends the way it did in the original design, and we'll slot in new classrooms. From a site standpoint, if you look, the next sheet shows the revised civil plan. There's very minor impacts to the original design. It was a couple of existing underground utility lines that we shifted a little bit to get them out of the way of the proposed addition, but didn't really incur any additional costs. Nitch, who was our civil engineer on the job, they did run a revised stormwater report, and there were no changes identified within the stormwater report. That was submitted as part of the minor amendment package. And also, the expansion does not impact any of the wetland resource areas. We don't get closer to any of those or anything of that nature. So very minor in terms of civil.
For you, Mr. Chair, just a quick question.
Go ahead.
So the underground utilities, if that was a spot for an addition, why would we run utility wires there? I mean, we're lucky we got to it before.
No, this happens to do with there was another line that was the way that it was, we had to move a catch basin to kind of get it somewhat out of the way. It wouldn't have been in line where the original ones. We're talking a matter of 2 feet. We shifted a line to just give it a little bit more buffer to get it out of the building zone. The next sheet after the civil plan is the revised landscape plan. So basically, that whole area that at the end of the building was primarily kind of an open lawn area. There was some enclosed planter boxes that we were proposing down at that end of the building. So that just kind of shifted, and it impacted. There's a walkway that runs out from an exit point in that building and actually connects back into another one of the breakout areas on the exterior. Those were some minor grading issues in reference to that as well. So primarily the planter area shifted west, and we did some minor modifications to the walkways, but same general, we didn't make any changes to layout or materials in this area. The next is the revised landscape plan. So we did shift some of the trees in and around there. We didn't add any trees, we didn't take away any trees. There were 9 trees in that area. There still are 9. We just had to move them around a little bit. And we probably have a slightly little bit more concrete walkway as the building extended. No, actually, it stayed exactly the same. Because that walkway was in the general position. It's just basically that the building shifted down.
Some on the way and some came back.
So then the next one shows what I was talking about. That's really what the addition is those two classrooms. We did want to move the last classroom out. There's a small group room at the end of the building, and there's a stair. We wanted to still have that be the end of the building, so the stair ends at the end of the building. And we slotted in 2 kindergarten classrooms on the lower level, and then there'd be 2 first grade classrooms on the upper level. In terms of architecturally, from an exterior, it's the same materials. We're just basically, it's going to be the same ones that were approved under the original submission. We've added now a couple additional windows, but it's all matching, replicating what the existing classroom spaces were. On the second floor, we did have to increase one of the stairs. It's actually the main stair, because we did have an additional occupant load for those classrooms up on the upper level. We did need to modify our main stair to make sure we maintain safe egress from the second floor.
It's wider?
Yes. We didn't get to 1,000 people on the upper level, which would have triggered a fourth means of egress. So we're actually at around 880, I believe, is what the designed occupant load on the second floor is. So we did modify that one stair again.
Is that for
sure,
like an open house day or something like that? Or how do you get 800?
Well, it's how the building code tells you. There's three different ways you do it, and you take the worst case.
Okay.
Yeah, but in real life, there's probably not more than 200 to 300 people up there at any given time. So next sheet, it does show just, again, what the impact to the layout for the classroom area is. But like I said, it's basically replicating the classrooms that were already there in terms of the equipment and the materials. And then the last sheet talks a little bit about traffic. Okay, and we did revise the traffic report, and we did submit that as part of the original submission. So I'm just going to give a synopsis of what that is. And what it basically talks about is that in our original study, we based a lot of the design on counts we did back in December of 2014, plus some, I wouldn't say historical data, but data for understanding how often people come there. It was a kind of a mix of those. And the design kind of showed that what we had in that original study was we were anticipating about 75 parents and 25 school buses at morning drop-off and 103 parents and 25 buses at afternoon pickups. So there, it gave us what the projected number of trips were for both the morning and the afternoon. Now, there's been three changes from the original study. First, the one that we did want to point out is that when we did the counts in 2014, that was based on what the enrollment for the existing school was. And at that year, there 443 was the enrollment. So that's really what the original design was on. So, you know, our new design, where we're talking about 480, there's really only a delta of about 37. It's not a delta of 80 of adding four new classrooms. Also, the town has implemented free busing. This is the first year where they've had that. And we did talk with the town, and what they were seeing is that in previous years, 17% is the number of kids who don't take the bus. And this year, that dropped to 11. So there are more kids actually taking the bus. So we went out and did additional counts, and we had about 12 days worth of counts spread over kind of three different weeks. So we talk about AM drop-off, PM pickup, and then buses. Now buses are constant because they have 25. They all come every day, morning and the afternoon. But the average is what we were finding is that right now there's about 43 parent drop-offs in the morning and on average about 37 pickups in the afternoon. The front lot that we had designed for has a total of 86 spaces in it. Four of them were handicapped spaces, and we did realize that there'd probably be some visitor spaces and a couple of admin spaces in that lot. But 75 were planned to be open. So under that design, it does show that we'd have more than sufficient parking in that front lot for the amount of afternoon pickups that they have. Now, in the report that we had done, we actually based it on two different scenarios. So we did a scenario where, again, if for some reason they discontinue the free busing, we went back to the 17%, but we also showed the one at the 11%. The one at the 17% without the busing basically reflects the original study design. It showed that, yeah, it was maximizing the amount of parking they had, but it wasn't showing that there would be a need for any additional parking. With the free busing, there's more than ample enough parking in that front lot for the afternoon pickup times. The one thing that was interesting is in the original study, we were what it was showing is that there were more in the afternoon than there were in the morning, but the actual counts that we're getting here is actually more drop-offs in the morning and less pickups.
Yes. You're so ready that's for the questions?
Gist. I have questions. I do have some of our consultants who were here and can speak if there are specific questions on specific items.
And you've got your consultants who've coordinated with ours.
Too. Sure. Yeah. So, questions from the board members? Questions from the public? Brian?
A quick question. Because we're just really, at this point, we're only focusing on this one wing. Do you know, or is there anyone from the school committee that can determine whether the preschool students are taking buses, or are they being dropped off and picked up?
Well, that I don't know. I don't know if they actually take the bus. I do know that they come at a different time than the kindergarten and first grade do. They come about, I think, a half hour later than what the kindergarten and first grades come, and they get released at a different time as well.
So the timings, so they don't, timings are different.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
Because I know that this is really only impacting, you know, first grade and kindergarten, but, you know, we're still talking about cars, you know, my concern was we're still talking about cars for preschool.
Mm-hmm.
And I want to make sure that that was accounted for, but if they're different times,
mm-hmm.
then it sounds like that's taken care of.
There are different times. I just don't know whether they allow them to take the bus or not. That's something I don't know.
And are there going to be more, do we know because of the free busing and the four extra classrooms, does that trigger more buses? I remember the bus loop is very tight.
No, they come in stages. So basically they come in, I believe, in two different stages. So six line up and six are waiting. So six get loaded, those buses leave, the next six pull in. And then it probably 5 to maybe 10-15 minutes later, another set of buses come in.
But we're talking about 85 students more than what was planned for initially, right?
Yeah, but if you look at the amount of students that get on each of those buses from that school, it's not impacting it. There's not, those buses aren't leaving fully loaded.
Okay.
I have a comment.
Go ahead.
I want to thank you guys for bringing these numbers to us. It's good to see metrics that are real from real data, and we can consider them, and it's good to have this information help us make decisions. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Other questions?
I have one question, Mr. Cool. Chairman. Hypothetically, if it exceeds the 85, is there capacity to add additional classrooms in the future? Does that scenario ever kind of come to fruition?
Well, right now, the enrollment projections don't support that. However, we only used half of the correct expansion capacity. So there is a chance that if for some reason 15 years down the road there is another spike and you say, you know what, what might make the most sense is to add some additional classrooms here, you could look at adding four more here. That would about cap it.
Okay. And that would take it to the left, right?
It would. It would. Correct.
I guess I'm still a little concerned on, I'm not as concerned on the parking spot given the numbers we've got, but we also have, I believe in the packet, there was 11 additional staff members for these four classrooms. And then I'm really worried because we have a bad habit of charging for busing every time we decide to cut the school committee's budget, and we just cut, what, $400,000 out of the school committee's budget a couple weeks ago. And, you know, that seems to be that between that and higher athletic fees for the kids, those are the first two things, and then we just go after the music program, I guess. But I worry about that area. At this point, but I also don't want to overbuild parking if we don't really need it, because that's not a good thing. I think maybe a
way to kind of hedge our bets a little bit might be to send a letter to the Irving Todaro committee and suggest that they either reserve a futures parking space in the land next to it, or if they're, when they're designing that bus parking potential in that area, that perhaps the bus parking could be used as overflow parking for the school, because the buses will be out circulating at that particular time. They could park where the buses normally sleep at night, and then, you know, the parents will be gone by the time the buses all get back from their rounds. And if either between your committee, Joe, sending that letter with jointly with the planning board to that other committee, suggesting that, you know, we all don't want cars backing up on Hayden Row Street. You know, we also have the, you know, the normal overflow of using EMC Park, which I think does there too, even though there is a, I believe, provision in the agreement with EMC Park where it's not supposed to be used for school stuff, but I would expect that if you're getting stuck in the parking lot, some parent is going to find that back door to the school to go pick up their kid. But
Mr. Chairman, yeah. Might I suggest, because our architect can't answer the question.
Sure.
He could answer the question if you were to ask, what if there were no free busing?
Yeah, I think that was kind of already, you know, you kind of already said that it kind of cooks us back to where it is, but yeah. Then I'm thinking of 11 spots. I know this board was a little concerned on parking before, and yeah. I think that there's a future planning element that if we reserve some land or reserve a joint function on that bus parking, if it's practical to put it close enough to the school, then you got it.
Mr. Chair, do I remember from the previous public hearing last year that the staff parking, actually we had to shift some staff parking into that front parking lot because there wasn't enough room in the back lot for all the
staff? I don't think it's that there wasn't enough. What we had thought was the people who were in the main entrance area, the main admin staff, may prefer to park in that front area just because it's closer for them. And that's where the visitor parking would be as well, because that entrance is really the only public entrance.
Right.
For the building. There's approximately, and I don't remember off the top of my head, I want to say there's 68 parking spaces in that bus lot, 66 or 68.
How many
63 it says.
63.
How many total classrooms do we have now?
In the new one?
No. Total.
Well, you have to count the pre-K as well. So there'd be 30. So you're going to have one teacher for each of those classes. You're going to have some kitchen and janitorial staff.
And a bunch of aides.
But they get a lot of those who come and go to the different schools. So they have someone who's going to come in the morning to visit with certain kids, and then they go to another school in the afternoon for other kids. So that was one of the things that I know. They wanted to have some of those parking spaces there, and they wanted to get them out in this lot so they can come and go as they need to. So there may be 60 teachers who are there, but there may only be 50 or 52 at any given time. I still think there's probably some spaces that could be open in that teacher lot.
If I could come in through the chair,
and
maybe it's more toward the committee, I think we have a strong consensus on the planning board that we would like to see the future parking in place, and it would help. It'd make it a little bit easier to expand now and in the future, but I think we're all on the same page on that. So
through you, Mr. Chairman, your suggestion is fine. I mean, I'd be happy to bring it back to the EMC. I think we would all agree that makes sense. We've even had discussions that if it were necessary, where would it go?
Okay.
So we'd be happy to write a letter with you to the Irvine Todaro study group,
and maybe the board of selectmen and the school committee is copied. You know, all just to make sure that everyone's on the looking on the same page.
Yeah, the ESBC had previously given input to the Irvine Todaro study group that future potential parking needs would be something that we'd want them to consider. So I believe they have, but we agree it would be worth following up again now that we have a revised plan.
Does your parking account for all the parent free aides? I know when my wife was on the PTA way back when, center school had all had one or two parent volunteers in there all the time. And I mean, I thought that was a good function of using the parents and free labor, and I think the kids all benefit from it too. Yeah. So I mean, there's potentially another 30 or 40 folks coming in for that too. I mean, I
don't know if it's 30 or 40.
I don't think you're going to get in the daily that amount.
What we used to.
How many extra spaces do we have, Judd, under the current three, Mr. Chair? Yeah.
On what, in the bus parking lot? That's it's a little difficult, like I said, to get an understanding of that, just because there's a lot of aides who come, and they come at different times. You know, we can work with Lauren to get maybe a more, maybe she can help us do some counts on different days as to how many there are. But I don't think you're going to have 63 every day there in that parking lot.
And keep in mind, three, Mr. Chair, the 86 spots in the front, they're not occupied. They're there for drop-off and pick-up, but then those parents leave.
Yeah, I mean,
is the volunteer aides, you know, the moms in the classroom.
Yeah.
They're going to take part of those 86.
Absolutely.
Yep. And during the day, it doesn't matter. It's just
those 86 would be available.
Right,
Right, yeah, Mr. Chair, I was going to say, as a former volunteer in the classrooms, you know, the volunteers are showing up after the school day starts, and they're leaving before the school day ends.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I do know they have, like, a lot of, I forget what they refer to them as, guest readers who come in and will read for the students or this class, but it did seem like they were, like you had indicated, in and out before the main drop-off and pick-up events happen.
Okay. I mean, that program was always, I thought, one of the strengths of Hopkinton school system, because we got a lot of bang for that very little dollars. And, you know, we did really well even in the sad times of Hopkinton school systems in the late 80s, and that center school has always done well because they had so many parent volunteers. Okay. I think we also heard from our consultants that everyone's happy with the groundwater aspect of it. I'm just kind of peering over there. Are there other questions, concerns from the board members?
I just want to reiterate. So we don't think that there's a need for more buses. We think that the capacity of buses that were planned for will be able to handle the additional students.
Yes.
Because I remember that loop was really tight.
Mm-hmm.
We got it.
But how it functions now, or in the original design, with how it's going to function after, it's not going to change. That's not going to
change. I just want to make sure that there's not a bus that's going to be sticking out and closing off that exit loop.
Nope.
Okay.
I think we are ready for two votes. One is a letter to send to send a joint letter to regarding the planning of the Todaro property. And Joe and I will work on drafting that one, I guess. So,
Jennifer will help us.
We'll let Jennifer do all the work, Joe.
Mr. Chair, I just have an unrelated general question. So maybe after this vote,
let's do this one, then you can ask. Yes. Okay. I entertain a motion to send a joint letter.
So moved.
Moved.
Second.
Second. Further discussion. Seeing none, how do you vote? Aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay, David.
Unrelated question. Just the solar panels in the picture in the front. I didn't think we were doing those right.
Yeah, that's an older diagram. We do have two areas where there are solar panels. There are some on the main, what we'd call main lobby roof. Right. But there is also a solar array on the gymnasium roof.
Okay. I just think it's a little deceptive that if we're really not doing it, we shouldn't be showing a picture. Or that just an outside comment. Thank you.
I think we need to have a...
saving money.
Yeah. We've already determined that they're minor, so then... I
I guess I entertain a motion to approve the minor modifications to the site plan for 129 Hayden Row.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion?
Just this real quick. This is 135 Hayden
Row. I think it's changed. I think the address is now 135.
The new address is 129.
Oh, it's 129? Okay.
Address. Yeah. Okay. When we went to town meeting originally, it was 135.
Okay. Since I've always used 129. Address,
right? 129 is the number checked.
129.
Okay. I think that's what I said in the motion.
It is. Okay. I just wanted to confirm because the handout we got says 135.
Got it. Okay. Let's see. Where are we?
Moved.
Okay.
What about Frank and John already?
Yes. We already got it moved. Oh, we're ready. Okay. We're ready for the vote.
Yes.
Okay. Ready for the vote? All those in favor of approving the minor modifications to the site plan at 129 Hayden Row, say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
good
guys.
Presentation.
Thank you.
We'll send you a letter. Shortly giving you the okay. But
all right, thank you.
But go hang some steel.
And thanks to your consultants, too, for working with us the last few years.
Thank you.
Yeah, it can't hurt to have it.
Okay.
Ken,
yes.
That letter going to Dinaro is going to request additional parking for the option two.
To consider it in their planning for the rest of the site for additional parking and or possibly dual use with the bus is for overflow?
Because there's one lot that could be an easy kind of overflow right off the staff parking area.
Yes.
Yeah. Just
from my ignorance, is that the main purpose of the Tadero property for the storing the buses, or is there going to be other?
No. We bought it with an unknown purpose.
Okay.
We bought it because we were in the mood to buy property at that town meeting. We probably paid too much for it. Let's see. The next thing on the item is the street acceptance report for the annual town meeting. We have Cider Mill Road, Cranberry Lane, Cold Spring Brook Road, and Pine Tree Lane. This finishes up, I believe, the work of streets that never got accepted in the 80s and were intended to do that. And the planning board has been expending money to get them surveyed and ready for acceptance. So I think I need to entertain a motion to recommend acceptance of these four streets to the Board of Selectmen.
That's correct.
And the town meeting.
That's correct.
So entertain a motion to accept or to entertain a motion to recommend to the Board of Selectmen and the town meeting the acceptance of Cider Mill Road, Cranberry Lane, Cold Spring, Brook Road, Pine Tree Lane.
So moved.
Second.
Moved seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Anyone abstain? Motion carries. Okay. Follow up on the warrants for the annual town meeting. We have, besides the one we kind of tabled this morning, earlier in the meeting, we have two other ones. One deals with signs, and the other one deals with
parking for hotels.
I think we should maybe bring these all up final time in one of our upcoming meetings. We haven't gotten any word back on the sign from town council. I believe the hotel were set, and Jennifer has done some research, which is in your memo, and we're going to have to start thinking about which number we put in there. We probably ought to think about that earlier than not. Why don't we think about tonight? Let's do something on the number.
She did some rather thorough research there.
Yes.
Yeah.
Thank you.
Kudos.
We have in the bylaw as it sits right now is what?
Right now you have nothing in your bylaw.
Right.
You're proposing 1.2 spaces per guest room, I believe it is. some people thought that might not be enough.
And that's irrespective of employees. It's just flat out 1.2.
Flat out 1.2 spaces. So as you can see, some other towns do one space per room, and then they'll calculate employees separately, and they'll calculate function space and restaurants separately, which, if you notice, I also wrote that I spoke with Chuck Cadillac, and the way our bylaw reads is that separate uses in our bylaw are also calculated cumulatively, so they would also be calculated separately. So if you have a hotel with a restaurant and with a function space, as long as those items are open to the public, the parking for those items would be calculated as they are calculated in our bylaw currently. So there would be extra parking required for those items separately. So really, the 1 or 1.2 or whatever is strictly for the hotel.
Mr. Chairman?
Yeah, go ahead.
Question through you, Jennifer. Outstanding work here, by the way. Did you get any verbal, anecdotal feedback from any of those towns saying, hey, we think we got it right, we didn't get it right?
No, most of the people I talked to felt like that it was satisfactory, adequately. Nobody's really ever had a problem with it. Nobody's talked about changing it or anything like that. It wasn't really part of our conversation, but, you know, in the course of our conversation, nobody really had any issues.
Yeah, curious if anybody had
any I did get some information from the city of Brookline, but I didn't include that because they were like half a space, and they were like, this may not apply to Hockington because it's a little bit different than Brookline. And I'm like, I'm not going to include a half a space per room.
Well, sometimes when I would travel with a project team, we'd have four guys in a car, and we're in four different rooms, so I mean, you get some of that.
Do that.
And the hotels are not necessarily 100% filled, but then again, you know, there is a lot more staff folks that all have their vehicles too.
Also, I did get some anecdotal information from somebody who works in this building. I'm not going to name names, but who used to be a maid in a hotel, who did say that when they worked in the hotel, it would be like most of the staff that was coming in with cars were the maids or the people that cleaned the rooms, and they were coming in when all the guests were leaving, so there was like a changeover, and there wasn't a need for additional staff.
That's good.
So I think what with the 1.2, if everyone feels comfortable with that, because they'll be printing the warrant, I wouldn't want to have to amend that on the floor just and take another half an hour at town meeting. So I'm seeing everyone's kind of comfortable with what Zach had recommended at this point, and I think that kind of, and we do have town councils on this one.
Yeah, the town council was happy with the language. And just the other quick thing to note, there was a couple, I forget what town it was, did mention that there are hotels too that have, like, their chains or their brands have standards, and so they'll know when they come in if our number is too low for them, they'll propose what they need because they know what they need.
Mm-hmm.
That makes sense.
So why don't we go ahead, because we've got this one wrapped up. I think we're all sitting here nodding.
Yeah.
Let's entertain a motion to recommend the hotel parking bylaw to town meeting.
So moved.
Second.
Moved and seconded. Further discussion? Seeing none, how do you vote?
Aye.
Aye. Anyone opposed? Anyone abstained? Motion carries. So now we only have two more left. The sign one, which is
always... Can I just ask on the utility structure, what you want from Ray Niaris, further clarification on his letter? Like, what specifically do you want me to ask him? Do you want him to attend a meeting? Like, what do you want me to ask him?
Why don't we leave it up for members to get individual things to it and really read it and kind of try to understand it to help make your...
Okay, can we put a deadline to that so that...
Yes.
That's on Ray's letter.
Yes, yeah. I just want to know what to be able to ask him to respond back to us.
Three days?
Okay. We'll say by the end of the week, by Friday.
Okay.
If you can give me whatever your questions or comments are to town council by Friday, and then I can put something together for him.
Okay. We're moving along pretty good. We got 5 minutes, and then we got the Eversource folks. Okay. Next one on here is a updated forecast for subsidized housing inventory. If you got this electronically, we made one number change, I believe, since you got it electronically. If you're looking at attendance.
Oh, I didn't think about that. You're correct.
So the version that if you got a paper packet, the dwelling growth, I think, was 27%, and it's really 29%. And that's because depends on which number you use for the denominator.
You don't get a paper copy, right?
I did get one, thanks.
Everybody else got one?
Okay, so let me try to explain this sheet. I believe we have an action item for the master plan to look at this on a regular basis. And we did this about a year and a half ago. And this is our forecast of what we expect to be built during this decade, which is what the next census is, and that's what the state uses for calculating the affordable housing index. So basically the top, we have basically 2011 through 2016 what the actual building permits were. Jen has forecasted Legacy North in the next few years of the decade, building out basically 240 of them, of which you can see five or six of them already sprouting up. We have remaining Masconet Woods, Highland Park 4, which nothing has started on that other than the roadways been basically done.
Well, I just recently went back to conservation to get some additional approvals, so I think they're getting back on track with that.
Okay.
And just quickly while we're on that,
yep.
Their roads were plowed. Did we do that or did they do that?
They did.
Oh, they're really nice.
The Pelican Estates, there's two left there. Hunter's Ridge, we have three left there. 2-3 Pond Street, there's eight left. Christian Way, it's got one left. Reservoir View, three. Sudbury River, I don't think that one, I think it got approved, but I don't.
So yeah, so that one doesn't technically exist anymore, but we, Lane and I talked about it, and we decided to leave it in there because it's a potential one that could come back.
Okay. Hinn's Farm, which we just approved the bond last week, and they started digging the cellar hole this week. 34 Hayden Row, which was recently approved. Legacy Farms, we think if they come in this summer, that maybe they would sell or build up to 120 through this decade. Saddle Hill Road is a subdivision that's going to come before the board second meeting in April. Chamberlain Whalen, we're talking about that. That's what they've got, the asterisks. We kind of put together a miscellaneous frontage lot of 30. These are all unknowns, really. I put a new affordable units at 0 and 0. If we thought we needed them to keep our 10%, we can always use the town land and some of the money that we have collected. And basically, we go from the 2010 and look at the existing subsidized housing index. And we estimate it, and we are at 11.18% at this point. Now the board members can use it, this sheet, for two things. One is it's a pretty good estimate of what we expect will get built between now and 2020. And two, when we make a decision, say on Saddle Hill Road or Chamberlain Wayland, as to whether or not we want the affordable unit to be built or take the money, we can. This number assumes that the unit's being built. We could take those four units out, rerun the calculation, make sure we're still above 10%. So anyway, it's a useful tool for members of the board, and we'll probably end up giving this also over to the school committee in cooperation with them, because that helps in their planning.
Mr. Chair, just a quick question.
Yeah, sure.
34 Hayden Row, so did that come before the planning board or no?
Mm-hmm. 34 planning, yes, that's the Threadmill.
Yeah,
the
Kidsborough.
Oh, okay.
Yeah.
Did that happen?
And that must have been maybe before I came on, or?
Well, it only came before the planning board for a parking lot. The board didn't have to do anything for the unit. So
right.
I'm sure I've asked you this question before, but what's the criteria? Only if they're looking for a variance, or do they come
Well, they got a variance from the Board of Appeals, which allowed it to go, and then the parking lot area got completely redone.
Yeah. No, I mean, normally a subdivision only needs to come before the planning board.
It's
if it
a
needs
conversion
to
of a, that was a conversion of an old mill, so that okay. was a subdivision.
Yeah.
Okay.
So that's something we didn't quite approve, per se, of on the area there.
Thank you.
And I have a question on this chart.
Yeah.
The affordable housing units on Legacy Farm South aren't listed.
So they're already included under existing SHI units.
Oh, okay.
For under where it says existing SHI units, 1016, where it says 720.
Okay.
They're already included.
And also, I would
Thank
assume
you.
That the...
I should take out the words as not including legacy farms. Sorry.
Oh, yeah. Well, this also... Where do we put... that number also has to include the...
includes the Muse.
The Muse. Okay.
It includes everything in town to date.
is in that SHI number.
That's correct.
Quick question for Jennifer.
Go ahead.
29% growth in 10 years. What other towns are growing at that rate? Are there any?
I believe there's some cities that are growing at that rate. I think there's a redevelopment in Chelsea and some places in the closer to Boston that are actually a little bit higher than Hopkinton, but we're probably one of the higher ones of this size community. This is less growth than we had in the 90s, if people remember back. I think we were in the 40% range or something like that in the 90s. So, but it's still a fairly reasonable number.
Yeah, I would say in this area, you're probably one of the faster-growing communities.
Well, as I've been known to blame the schools for that, and they do such a wonderful job of educating our kids that people want to live here, and then also the location, so, you know. Okay, we've now wandered by 8:30, and that's our time for Eversource, so we're doing pretty good. We'll take up all the rest of the stuff after Eversource. So, Joanne, are you going to lead the crew here?
Thank you. Good evening, everyone. Hi, Mr. Chairman, Planning Board members. I'm Joanne O'Leary, Eversource Community Relations Specialist. And joining me, I'm just trying to make room for you guys. I'll introduce Jim Blackburn. Jim is our project manager for our liquefied natural gas facility here in Huffington. And with Jim are two consultants that we're working on for the project team. I'll let them introduce themselves separately. And I think I'm going to take a seat back here. Is there
we'll
enough room?
We'll take these. I think that's
okay.
If you don't mind.
Okay.
And thank you for this opportunity.
Oh, you're welcome.
Justin Smith, I'm with CH4 International, an LNG consulting firm out of Baltimore, Maryland.
I'm Roberta Perez. I'm with Eversource. I'm a project engineer.
Welcome.
So appreciate you.
Just one consultant.
Just one consultant.
I'm sorry. Okay.
That's okay. No worries.
We appreciate the board taking the time to give us an opportunity to introduce the project. I think some of you may already be aware of this. I was here, I think, in December for a project at the plant, and I think we talked briefly about this. Really, what we wanted to do tonight is give you an introduction to the facility, to the liquefier project, kind of update the board as to where we stand and what our intentions are over the next couple of years, and also gather some feedback, I suppose, from the board so we can better understand maybe some of the things that you'd like to maybe see incorporated, any reasonable requests that we have. I think we're at a point now where we're kicking off the design phase, and if there's things that we can incorporate in the design, this would be the time that we could easily do that. So as long as we have some reasonable requests, I think we'd certainly like to entertain some of that feedback from you. I think I can speak for all of us that we appreciate you before.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I know. You know, you started out this meeting talking about zoning exemptions, and we do plan on going forward with a zoning exemption. We plan on filing that in about the next month. Having said that, we do find it important to try to get out a little earlier in the process instead of waiting for that zoning exemption to get filed with the state and then looking for feedback. So we want to take the opportunity. I know we're presenting to you. We're looking to possibly host an open house in the very near future, and we're also looking to try to get in front of the Board of Selectmen to maybe present a little bit further to the rest of the town. So what we did is we wanted to bring some preliminary design information that we've got, kind of plot plan, things that, you know, kind of talk about some of the benefits of the project, both to us and then maybe to the local community. We want to talk a little bit about our schedule and then just kind of highlight what it is that we're doing. So if I can turn this around here, Justin, if you don't mind being our easel. The existing facility is on the west side of Wilson Street, as you know. What our project is doing, and this is a little difficult to see, I apologize for the print, but we're planning on taking our liquefaction equipment, which is located up in the main process facility. We're looking to take those engines and the process gas processing equipment, moving that over to the tank farm side of the plant, so on the east side of Wilson Street. This equipment would essentially be abandoned, and the new facility would end up over in this area, out behind kind of Tank C area. That is being taken on. The facility is 50 years old. The existing liquefaction equipment is, at this point, becoming more difficult to maintain. We're looking to kind of enhance the process. We're looking to ensure that we can maintain the equipment. We see a lot of benefits with the new technology. We'd be looking to go from a refrigeration system that utilizes some more volatile, I guess, propane, ethylene, some you know, combustible gases that we can replace now with a system that utilizes nitrogen. So with the nitrogen system, we have less hazards on site. We basically would be eliminating about 16,000 gallons of between
of refrigerant
ethylene
storage and flammable refrigerant storage and moving to nitrogen, which is non-flammable
inert, and we don't have to take that in on property and maintain that. So what we would be doing is our intention, again, we're eliminating this equipment, moving it to the west side of the property. Our intention is to get it back up off the street and kind of tuck that around the backside of some existing trees. We have very limited site clearing that we'd expect to do this. We're thinking we're less than 4 acres. In fact, we're thinking we're quite a bit less than that. It's really not a large impact to that area that we own back there. That's all previously disturbed property from when they built these tanks. We have little to no disturbance to the existing wetlands. We're within the 100-foot buffer zone. We currently have no facilities or encroachment on the actual no disturbance or no build zone. We will be crossing the street with two of our pipelines up here at Wilson Street, and there is a wetland that's right in the corner of that pipe rack. We're looking at some different design potentials there where we could utilize the existing pipe rack so we stay out of that wetland. We may have some minor disturbance at least working around there, but right now our intention is to try to get it up on the pipe rack and stay out of that.
Mr. Chair, the reason for the pipes running back across?
So what we'll be doing is actually we'll be eliminating several existing pipes and we'll be going down to some smaller size pipes. By moving the liquefaction equipment to this side of the property, currently today, during the summer, when we were making LNG liquid, we have to take that from the main facility and send that down to the tank farm where we store it. In the future, we'll be making that liquid down at the tank farm, so we will no longer be crossing the road during the summer, which tends to be, if we had empty tanks and we started at the beginning of the summer, it would take us between 150 and 180 days to fill those tanks. So you'd have liquid flowing 24 hours a day during that operation. In the future, or currently, we have to, during vaporization, which is the winter time frame, there's about capacity here for 12 days of send out. During send out, we have to take that LNG and send it back up to the vaporizers. In the future, that'll stay the same.
Okay.
But what we will be doing is eliminating that 150 to 180 day potential where we're putting liquid into the line.
The vaporizers will stay over there.
The vaporizers will stay. That's right.
Great. They just modernized that this last
past
year.
Summer. Yeah.
Great.
So, you know, we think that's a benefit by taking the liquefaction operation that runs, you know, a big portion of the year, moving that over to the same side of the road. We have air emissions. We'll be utilizing out of the four existing engines, we'll be adding a gas turbine, getting rid of those four engines. The gas turbine has a little better emissions profile than the existing gas engines. It'll also eliminate, we have four boil-off compressors. Those four compressors run year-round. Two of those will go from being engine-driven to electric motor-driven, and we believe that those will run probably 90% of the year, so we'll eliminate the emissions from at least two of those engines, so we'll be cutting back a lot on that. So we think there's a benefit.
When he says engines, these engines, each one of them is as big as this room.
Yeah, they're about two stories tall.
They're about 2 stories tall.
And are they loud, right?
They are. Now they're inside of a building.
They're inside of a building, but I hear it. When I run up there, I can hear something going on. And my question is this going to reduce some of the peripheral noise that you hear as a result? Even when we walked, Mr. Chairman, when we walked over, if you remember, when you walked through the woods there, you could hear... Mm-hmm. I assume that it was the compressors or the engines or something.
So I guess the question are electric engines quieter?
Electric engines are quieter than
the electric engine turbine. Should be. And
well, electric motors, yeah, much quieter than gas turbine. But this turbine will be in an enclosure inside a building, and we'll be doing sound mod. Well, one of Eversource's consultants will be doing sound modeling on that arrangement, determine if any soundproofing is needed in the building as well.
We've actually already engaged MassDEP about doing some baseline sound modeling. So we went out there in the beginning of January, February, and did one set of base modeling. So we went on the peripheral of the property line, set up monitoring stations, and they did a 72-hour, I think it was, data gathering. And we actually got some feedback from the DEP, and we ended up going back out. They were out there last weekend doing it again. So we're trying to do it, you know, when there's no leaves on the trees. We're trying to, you know, get it at night when it's the quietest it should be. And then what happens is we base the new design so that we don't affect, basically we don't add 10 decibels of sound to the property.
Question is going, what's the baseline today? What's your decibel count today? I don't know, make it up 80. I don't know what that is. Is a new one going to be 70? New one going to be 90?
So I think the baseline was from the last set of data was about 40 dBA, and the new cannot exceed 10 additional dBA. So basically you're constrained to an additional 10 dBA on the baseline. So the baseline again is set in the middle of the night on a cold winter day. So we will, you know, there's a couple things that we're taking into account to help reduce sound emissions. The loud equipment is all indoors, right. So all the engines will be indoors in insulated buildings. The gas turbine is indoors inside of an enclosure. The filters and the stack arrangements, those will all have, you know, sound deadening devices on them to help limit some of those noise exposure.
It's not going to make it essentially...
Not silent.
Or it's not going to change it much from where it is today.
No,
I think the new turbine will probably be further from the road than where the existing engine is.
Mm-hmm. It'll
plus it'll have, you know, planting on a nice buffer of trees between that and the road as well.
So, I mean, one thing to note, right? Legacy Farms is up in this area, and you have quite a few new residents that'll be up in that area. We'll be taking a lot of that summer operation and moving it down to what I would say is a little bit more secluded area for that area of the town. We have a flare that we have to add. Now, a flare initially sounds like a bad thing to add. We currently have two on the other side of the road. Those two, particularly during summer operation, have to run 24 hours a day. Not at full capacity, but they have to run 24 hours a day. The new flare down here, because we're using a nitrogen system, because we are using a gas turbine that's going to burn some of the...
boil-off gas.
The heavies, which is a byproduct of the process. because we'll be installing a gas turbine that will utilize those, we will no longer need to flare continuously during the summer operation. So it'll only be utilized, all three flares will only be utilized for process upsets. So that would be probably less than 2% of the year compared to today where we have to run it continuously during the summer. Again, at a small rate, but you know, we're limited to very few days out of the year where you have any, and it's a matter of minutes, not hours.
Quick question, I always see that flare from a distance, but a lot of times I can't see it. Is it just because it's running so small?
It's either typically not running or just on its, you know, pilot at very minimal load. During the summer, it has to run to burn some of the heavy hydrocarbons. This process will use those as a fuel source for the gas turbine. A couple things, I guess, that we're doing up by the street. So we took, originally this facility was designed to be up a little closer to the street. We've taken that, moved that back in the property. When we did that, we felt that we provided a better buffer to, I guess, you know, anyone driving by or walking by on the road. Line of sight, we expect to be pretty limited from the roadway of being able to see any of the new process equipment. We will be doing some new grading and paving of kind of our truck unloading area, so that'll stay the same. We're not touching that area. We're not touching the truck unloading equipment. We're just regrading that to make it a little more smooth for a truck to come in. We won't have that guard shack that's up on the road. Our intention is to move that inside the property, so we're not right out, you know, within a couple feet of the roadway there. So our plan is to kind of dress up that front area and make that maybe even visually a little, aesthetically a little bit better than what it is today.
The pipes going across the street, are they going to be above ground?
There's an existing culvert in our going under the road. Our intention right now is to try to utilize the existing culvert. If not, we would do a directional drill under the road. So you still wouldn't see it.
I don't remember the culvert. How deep is it roughly?
It's only a few feet under the road. And it's a box, concrete culvert. So it's just a big box.
All right, thanks.
Again, because we're eliminating several lines, we think we have plenty of room to bring back the two that need to be there.
Sure.
We're trying to really impact very little up in this front area of the property. So, I guess from a scheduling perspective, we've contracted with a engineering and construction firm at the beginning of this year. They're just kicking off the project from an engineering standpoint, so we have probably till the end of this year for that process to go forward.
So 2017 engineering?
2017 engineering.
That's going to be my question. Okay. Standards for 2017, not 50 years ago.
Correct. It's based on federal safety standards for LNG, which is regulated by the Department of Transportation, actually. And their code requires certain reference standards, like the National Fire Protection Association's 59A standard. And so they dictate which standards are used.
So the new facility, though, from a standard standpoint, will not be built to the same standards as this section of the facility. It'll be built to the new code, which is NFPA 59A 2001.
I want to make a point here, though.
Sure.
If you had to build this from scratch, you wouldn't be able to build it there by today's standards either.
I don't know if that's true.
Well, the tank would be, because the tank is grandfathered,
you couldn't get the tank on that side. Yeah.
A new tank. I don't know if any modeling has been done to.
And just based on this drawing, I would like to see more security fencing around the entire new area.
Yes.
Like we have currently.
So the existing, there's already an outer perimeter fence, we'll say, not really a security fence.
The double.
There is an inner fence that exists.
Okay.
That inner fence right now is actually this kind of line that you see here. The new property will have a fence that comes around the outside with cameras and the other, you know, equipment that we traditionally have at our facilities.
Thank you.
Well, the new facility, as you move it over there, right now there's no facility over there, so it's quiet, right? Mm-hmm. As you move the new facility, will that then have a decibel count around that 40 or so range?
Yes, so the baseline modeling is for this area, and so we do not change that more than the 10 decibels.
So, Mr. Chairman, questions for you. Are there any residents within shouting distance of where the new facility is going to be
I potentially could hear some of that additional noise from the new facility.
The closest is Mr. Smith by the mill, I would think.
Yeah.
And I don't know whether anyone lives in the place that he also owns right across from the state park headquarters.
People do live there.
People
there
is, do?
Yeah.
Okay. So that person would be the closest.
I believe, I think the noise policy by MassDEP talks about the nearest receptor. I'm not sure if it's just the property line.
When you're
looking
does.
At the sound impacts.
So
just bring it up.
So. Absolutely. So, I mean, where we're citing this over here, we've been able to give ourselves not only a pretty large buffer to our property line, but particularly over there with DCR and then, you know, Wood Realty Trust, we do believe, as far as our property consists of today, it's probably the most ideal location from perspective of trying not to, you know.
Where's the property lines again? Sorry, roughly.
So Eversource owns all the way up Rafferty Road, actually, on both sides of the road. Yeah. And then down on this section.
Hugs this way a little bit.
Okay.
And it comes down to kind of off this map over in this area.
Off the map is fine. Thanks.
Right across from me.
And then up to the right, is it along the dirt road there? Or?
Up in here, this is Legacy Farms.
Yes, the new one.
We own the property up, kind of up here. Sorry, Justin. DCR is over here near Roberta. Wood Realty Trust. Kinder Morgan is on either side of us, the pipeline company.
Okay.
And then we also own some property down here, and then Legacy Farms is on the back side of us, which we do. You're probably more aware of this than I am, but we do have a buffer restriction around the outside edge of the property.
Yep.
So we do try to kind of limit our...
Yep.
Okay.
Thanks.
Through the chair.
Yeah, go ahead, John.
What happens to the abandoned equipment and that site? Is it restored or is it just...
So what our intentions are, we install the new process equipment. That will probably take place in 2019. It'll come into service that summer. We'll run the equipment. The reality is we probably won't have a full summer's worth of testing. So we'll put that equipment away for the winter season. We'll go through our vaporization season. The following summer, we'll liquefy for one more season, prove out the equipment. At that time, all of this equipment on this side gets demoed. So we'll take it out of service in 2019, but we won't necessarily demo it right away until we prove out the new system. 2020 comes along, everything works well. That equipment then will be removed from service and removed from the property. So anything outside the building at this point, it's our intentions to demo and take out. So this will end up, this gravel area, and this, like, these facilities over here are actually the pipeline company, they're not ours. But all of these process equipments, this heaters and other vessels, that'll all be removed from the site. Maybe show just kind of a very conceptual, I guess, depiction of kind of what the facility would look like. So you've got your three existing tanks. Our intentions is there's a compressor building up here on this side of the property. As you drive in the access road, that'll have those four smaller compressors, two which would be electric driven, and then the two gas-fired engines. In the back, you have your process equipment and your main compressor building, which is this larger building. That's where the gas turbine would be located. That's really the major prime mover for our compressor for the nitrogen refrigeration system. These are all fin fan coolers, which are basically air-cooled heat exchangers. That's our cooling process, so we won't be utilizing any city water or anything as a cooling mechanism. We'll do that all on site with the fin fans. And then the process equipment we have behind those. So you've got to imagine from the roadway, you're looking this direction. We're trying to block the process equipment with both the buildings and the fin fan coolers and kind of take that stuff that visually is not overly pleasing and we'll kind of block that with the buildings themselves. Again, especially with the wetlands over in this area, we really aren't touching the vegetation. So we still believe we'll have a barrier on that side to prevent some of that.
I have a question. Has our fire chief seen these new drawings?
I don't think.
I'm not sure.
Yeah. I don't think we've had the opportunity to present this to Chief Slam yet. Quite honestly, I believe publicly you are the first group to be able to see these. Again, we have kind of a list of folks that we'd like to get these around to. This is very preliminary. We have a long ways to go. So over the next couple of months, this will further develop and what we'd like to do is be able to come back and just keep you updated as the process. Again, our intention is to go through the state process, but I think it's important to at least keep you appraised of what we're doing. Is there any, I guess, questions at this point? I can't answer anything maybe too technical, but I think...
I've got a list of questions.
Okay, I was curious about what variances you'd be looking for.
So I think we have some issues with height. I think 35 feet is the agricultural zone height restriction. We have a couple of these columns are up to, I think our tallest structure, it might be the stack, was it less than 50 or around
50 feet.
Yeah, less
than 50, but probably more than 40.
Still,
but not taller than tanks.
Not taller than the tanks, and we don't believe we'll be above the tree line either.
You said stack. Is that the coal box there?
These are the coal boxes here, okay. And then this stack here for the gas turbine.
Oh, okay.
And the only
reason for that's that's exhaust stack for
that's
that.
Right.
Okay,
and
the other two things are flare stacks.
Those are the contactors for the amine pretreatment.
Okay.
He's our mechanical engineer. Mechanical?
Yeah, I got one of those.
Process chemical?
These were just practice questions over here. These are the real questions.
The flare stack, which you can't, it's actually this object.
A little short.
It's kind of over on the corner here. So, it's a process flare. It really shouldn't be running ever unless there was an upset condition. A compressor shuts down. It should be fairly limited.
Okay. Let me take some of my questions, and then it'll kind of maybe, and these are just off the top of my head, and they're in random order because I thought of them as I'm thinking. One of my major concerns is the road crossing. Mm-hmm. You know, we did that study that you're well aware of, and it still scares a lot of people because the consequences are there. Okay. And it's a scenic road. I think we've already indicated in past meetings that we're more than willing to work with you on it. Because it's not as scenic there as it might be. But
sorry for clarity. What is a big concern there?
The report the town did would be as if somebody ran off the road and damaged the pipes. It would be a major...
I thought we mitigated that, or was mitigated.
It's partly there, but...
We took some measures over the summer to independently address that with some additional, stone barriers. I think we've talked internally. I don't know if we've necessarily incorporated this in the design, but I knew that from our prior meeting, and I think we've discussed some ways that we could incorporate that into the design. Again... As you've indicated, it is a scenic road, so we want to make sure that we'll be more than happy to cooperate
on safety over
the scenic view.
But you can also make them look halfway decent. That's the next one. So the approval process that you require is at the state level only, or do you have to go to federal approval?
Just at the state level for this facility.
Okay, so you're at the DPU for this?
That's correct.
Let's see. Do you, for the vapor exclusion zone for the new liquefier, do you own or control all the property within that?
The facility will be designed to meet 193 and 59A with regard to the vapor dispersion zones. Right now we did some preliminary modeling. The design is not there yet to do a final, but any mitigation measures that might be required will be put in place.
Okay.
So the short answer is we will be on our property
for
the dispersion modeling. So currently we are pretty close. I think we haven't done.
We are very close, and the modeling techniques used at this point are very conservative. So when we get more detail and we do a more detailed analysis, we think it'll be even better.
Are you going to need any property from Wood Part or Wood? You think you
we
even the vapor?
We're fully on property.
Okay.
And again, we're still very preliminary, but with the preliminary numbers that we've been given and the very conservative modeling we've done, we don't even believe will be up to the roadway, which I believe the roadway, you're allowed to cross into the roadway, but we don't expect to even be into that area. So we will fully be within our property.
Yeah.
Okay.
On that point, can I ask a question? Through the chair, sure. They own this property that's adjacent to the where they're talking about the new construction?
Yeah, they own the radio tower. We own
the radio tower property. We lease that to a communications company.
Okay, so that's like cell phones and stuff.
I think.
Is that the Doppler?
No, yeah, it's
that's Channel 5.
Yeah, the weather. One of the weather.
Oh, okay.
Channel.
Cool.
Yeah. Okay. Do you flare the PCBs?
PCBs?
I don't.
Yeah. Every pipeline's got PCBs in it.
Flaring of PCBs specifically, I'm not sure. I don't understand the question necessarily, because this is not something that's typically done at an LNG facility. The only thing that will be flared is any gas from process upset, mm-hmm. Which would not be a typical operating condition. We will have another incinerator or thermal oxidizer that will break down any contaminants in the gas through thermal oxidation before releasing CO2 and water vapor into the atmosphere.
When you talk about PCBs up here, I think you're talking about the what's often found left over in the pipelines from the compressor station.
Sure, and I know the Algonquin line is full of them.
Yes, yeah. However, I can tell you it gets less and less every year.
I'm sure
coming from gas distribution with NSTAR, when it was NSTAR, I guess, from the engineering group. When we did work in Cambridge, Somerville area, PCBs were always found in the lines. When you did a swipe sample of the lines, that was very common. Down here, in fact, we did swipe samples during the vaporizer replacement this past summer. We came back with no PCBs, which is pretty typical for around this area. We don't typically find PCBs in our lines down in this area. New Bedford area,
I think your vaporizer should be clean because you got rid of them upstream of that with the liquefaction process.
That's true, but on the fuel gas piping, which comes directly from our fuel meter. So the same gas line that gas is coming in on any residential. So I know exactly what you're talking about. We do see that in Somerville and Cambridge quite frequently, residual. We don't see it in the Hopkinton, Worcester area very often, once in a while in New Bedford area. But we don't expect to have to flare any PCBs. We don't even have heavies, a flare. Well, I guess the flare would handle any heavies in an upset condition, but again, we plan to utilize them as a fuel source.
Yeah. Okay. So you're probably burning them too.
Right. If not in the heavies.
Okay. Which contractor have you selected? Is that public knowledge?
It is. They announced it publicly. It's OnQuest, which is Primoris Services Groups.
How do you spell that?
O-N-Q-E-S-T?
Yeah.
O-O-O-N-Q.
OnQuest. They built several facilities recently of a very similar nature and process.
Okay. So we got the schedule.
So currently, we're in the engineering phase over the next 12 months, we'll say. So this is 2017. 2018 will be a continuation of engineering, the procurement phase, and then some preliminary construction activities, site enabling type stuff with major construction between 2018 and 2019.
Just a quick follow-on. You mentioned they built, OnQuest company built a couple facilities. Do you know the areas, the states, or?
One was in Miami.
One was in Miami, one was in California, in Pennsylvania.
Perfect, thank you.
Are you going to be hauling in lots of dirt or hauling out lots of dirt?
We actually currently have a zero, what would we call it?
A net zero cut and fill plan.
Yep.
Plan.
We are going to limit as best as possible any trucking in and out of there. As you know, that is not the most ideal location for getting you know, access in and out. So we will be coming up Rafferty Road with any, you know, equipment deliveries, but the current property, the current plan is not to be bringing or removing much fill. Now, again, we just did our geotechnical survey work
at the site.
So, you know, we'll certainly keep you updated if something was to change there.
You're going to be bringing in a lot of gravel or making your own?
There's certainly an opportunity to do that with all the rock out there.
They plan on moving existing spoils in the facility to accommodate the elevation that the plant would have to be at.
You aware of the construction noise?
We are, and our contractor is well aware of it. So
okay.
Talking about the schedule.
What?
Talking about the schedule.
Yeah. Okay.
So 7 to 4, 7 to 5, and whatever and Saturdays. We're aware of it, and it's in their contract. So.
Okay, great. And the Hopkinton's finest do enforce it.
And that's fine.
I read about it all the time.
Let's see.
If I may, we are very sensitive. I mean, a lot of our neighbors are, you know, the Tennessee Gas Company, ourselves. There's a few others, obviously, but we recognize that there are residential neighbors to us in that area, and even during the vaporizer construction, we try to be extremely sensitive to that. So we talk every time school comes back in session. We talk with our contractors to be very mindful that students are out waiting for the school bus at 7 a.m. about the same time that you're coming into work. So we definitely try to ensure that our folks that are going to be working on site, commuting to the site, are very much aware of the community around them.
Mm-hmm. I guess maybe I'll finish with on the gas side here. You know, Hopkinton is implemented with Legacy a bunch of Sentinel lanterns on your eastern side. Would you think about doing some of those along on your western boundary? We're still worried about, even while you are grandfathered on the tanks potentially create a very large vapor zone in a worst-case scenario that we all pray never, ever happens. But
I think we'll take that back, because I really can't. Yeah. I can't speak to that.
I think there's a lot of facilities like this that are in even more urban areas that, you know, were built in a certain time and operate under being grandfathered. But I think, you know, there's a good track record of safety in the LNG industry. And I'm not aware of any other towns that are, or areas where that are implementing that sort of thing.
We're also a little bit concerned that during the state review process, we certainly can't speak for them, but we don't know if there's ever been a precedence for something of that type, and we'd be concerned that potentially the state DPU may not recognize that as a design feature of our facility and take exception to that. Certainly, we'll take that back to our group, though, and talk through that. So I can't formally, you know, respond to that request at this point. But again, we're looking for your information and what you want to see.
I think that would go a long way.
That's goodwill.
It really is. I mean, you know, if there's a problem, and God forbid, it doesn't get to more residences that are within that vapor exclusion zone for the tanks. And that's why we implemented on the east side, or otherwise we couldn't permit the development that's going on. And I have another simple question. Joanne, is the solar farm still going?
I haven't heard any update on that. I know they had the lantern request was being reviewed.
Okay, because the solar farm is on the, you know, across from Rafferty, mm-hmm. And obviously solar farms are also an ignition source.
That's true, but keep in mind, our intention and all of our modeling is extremely conservative, and currently we do not come even close to that property. We don't leave our property, and we certainly don't get to the other side of Rafferty Road
for liquefier.
Say that?
For the liquefier.
For the liquefier project.
Right. The modeling that we had done on it, basically both our consultants said that keeping trees did a lot of good job of helping mix and limiting the area per se. Mm-hmm. And if you're clearing for the solar farm and then also adding an ignition source, I don't have so much problem with ignition source in many ways because, quite frankly, that limits where it's going to go. But
is that not the intent of the Sentinel lanterns?
Yeah, it's to protect the people. And the Sentinel lanterns are actually going to be further, as proposed, to be on the north side of the solar farm. So it would be the farthest way.
Right.
Our consultants, at one point, we thought about extending the lanterns up and down Rafferty Road. And our consultant says, well, you know, maybe that's not the best thing because, you know, something happens and it isn't huge, it's just big. You know, you might get lucky and not get to them. So they both can agree that going down Rafferty Road was, because the town felt that we could box it in. And I know the selectmen are looking at a similar type proposals. We don't really want to box it in, but we would like to protect the people on Reservoir View Road, etc., and state park folks. I mean, there are potentially 10,000 people on a warm August day within the vapor exclusion zone at the state park, or very close to it. You know, it goes all the way over to at least the swimming area. Okay. So that's the concern, and I think you'll find that a few lanterns will go a long way of making people at the town feel much more comfortable with it.
Okay.
Oh, last question I have. The fact that you move it from one side of the road to the other, does that affect property taxes?
We believe it probably is a benefit to the town and on the tax basis. I don't know if we've gone too deep into that, Joanne. I know we had discussed that.
It's been discussed. I know they're looking at all of the project property tax benefit for the town.
But you take a facility that was built almost 50 years ago, and you can imagine it's pretty well depreciated at this point. Obviously, the new facility, it's a little over $100 million, and you have to imagine that your tax basis should increase with the new equipment that's installed.
I would hope so. But I just didn't know whether there was some exemption. But
I'm not aware of anything. We fully expect to be paying taxes
okay.
on the equipment.
Okay, that's good. That's
I think
good.
I think, and from a town perspective, that's probably the big benefit to you.
Do you, Mr. Chair?
Yep.
I remember, I think it was the last time you were in here, if it was somebody else with the more recent project of the, I think it actually was the parking lot across the street.
Yes.
We talked about possibly putting some sidewalks in there, and I don't know if you guys could consider that. I mean, maybe, you know, just for even a small run.
Yeah,
I think it was for your guys to get across the road, wasn't it?
We had talked how we have kind of the same concerns.
Yeah.
We try to, you know, this driveway ends here, and this other driveway is about 20 feet further up the road.
Yeah.
So we did talk about how, you know, that may be something that we could certainly consider. I think with maybe some of the other work at the pipe crossing, that could be something we could incorporate. This is, well, it's not nearly as bad as the road down this way, but
right.
but this is fairly tight. There's a lot of walkers on that, and, yeah. you know, they walk the dogs up and around that area. So certainly we don't necessarily want to encourage more traffic in front of the property, but I think you've already got that there, so potentially that's you know, something we could incorporate.
Well, we only have 600 more units going on the north side.
That's right.
So
so the head of the DPW was just in there a few minutes ago, but I think I can speak for this. The preference for the sidewalks is to have a green belt between the sidewalk. And we prefer a curb, mm-hmm. a berm, if possible. But if not, if there's not enough room, you know, obviously the sidewalk and the berm can be joined together. So, I don't, just something to consider while you guys are throwing it together.
Yeah,
I don't think the town has any plans to put sidewalks on Wilson Street anytime in the near future for you know, so it'd be really mainly for you at that point.
I don't know how far we would be able to go, and I guess we do own.
We'd look at it.
We own up to the corner there, so certainly maybe it's something that we could do from there. And honestly, with the truck traffic, I think it benefits probably everyone. I mean, it doesn't help me if we're bringing trucks in and there's folks walking down the middle of the road. So
I think to the chair's construction, point, yeah. The chair's point, we may not connect at any point, but we look at it as anything you can do is a help.
Sure. Yeah.
Because you're going to have a sidewalk on Rafferty.
Sidewalk's already there.
Yeah, that's what I mean. Right, so you already got that sidewalk there. Something you can say, it's going to stop at the property line because it's not going to go down Wilson as it goes into 135.
And just to speak to sidewalk, I'm a big fan of the elevating of the sidewalk, having it at the curb height, because Rafferty is
it's not
a good,
my favorite sidewalk in town.
It's not a good model in my mind, but
no, I understand.
Okay. I just got two more questions for Joanne. I see you're making progress on Franklin Road. There's some wires on the poles.
Okay, that would be the riser pole.
So it looks like you've made some progress, but there's no wires getting to the development yet.
Well, yeah, I provided an update. Yep. Maybe. Okay, so the developer is actually responsible for installing the conduit, and once that's installed, it actually gets then inspected by an Eversource field worker, and then once approved, we can energize that. Okay. And so at the time I met the last time I met, maybe a month ago, that work still hadn't been done by the contractor. And I'm told that they meet each week reviewing what it is that needs to be done. So there are, you know, fresh eyes on that each week. But right now we're actually waiting for the developer.
Okay. Double poles. You guys make any progress on those?
Well, yes. I think it was School Street. That was a struck pole, and it's unfortunate because you just had Verizon in here, and Verizon sets the poles, and so we've notified Verizon off that, provided them with the field update, and it's their responsibility to set the pole, and then once it's set, we get notice to transfer wire and equipment if it's on that pole.
Is that the only double pole?
No.
Yeah, the double pole, there's a double pole database, and you know, with you know, the ones that were mentioned, we're in good shape. If there's a few poles out there that we haven't transferred, sometimes it's just a matter of doing a circuit update, or it's involved with the project. I know that's true in and around the Legacy Farms area. That I think those were the poles that were brought to my attention, and so there's reasons for that. You know, I don't know, you know, if you want to have Verizon give you an update, or, you know, it's, you know, each party knows their responsibility, and we take ours serious. Well, we have dedicated crews. They've been moving from town to town, currently in Natick, as a matter of fact. Next stop is Wayland. And then those are dedicated crews that we are, you know, doing for double poles. So if there's a poll that you want me to check, we certainly can. But of the ones that were brought to my attention, all were checked. We're clear of all of them.
Mr. Chair, so when you said we're clear, we're good on them, what kind of, like, within the next year or two, they'll be addressed, or?
Well, we have done our share, so okay. What happens is Verizon. The pole
okay.
is set,
okay.
We do our wire transfer, it goes to the next party.
Okay.
It could be the town for, you know, for anything that they may own,
right.
And then it jumps down to communications. Usually, is there fire wire on the poles?
Nothing
I don't
active.
Think so.
It's all,
okay.
You have a green light from me.
Okay. And then it goes to Verizon at the end.
Thank you. As you said, Ken, with the tops cut off,
yep.
Most of the time Eversource has done their work and it's waiting on Verizon.
Right.
Whoever is on.
Yeah.
Oh,
yeah.
Mm-hmm. Last question I have for you, Joanne. Are you planning to come in with a plan of what you're going to do for the secondary coming out of the new South Street facility addition?
Yes. So there's a proposal that will be seeking permission for a grant of location with the Board of Selectmen, and where we need to bring conduit from our station on South Street, and it goes up the entire length of South Street and then turns right onto West Main, probably to about Lumber Street. And at this time, there's just a few street cross, or there's a few crossings that we have with our plan. And I just spoke to Mr. Westerling today, and I just the folks just need to sit with him maybe 30 minutes just to clarify a few different crossings. And then once we get his approval, we'll be approaching the Board of Selectmen to be on their agenda.
And that's all going to be underground?
All underground.
Mm-hmm. Okay. It'll go nicely with the sidewalk over it. Maybe. Okay.
Okay. You know, it's probably it's a tight dangerous area with everything in the road and yeah.
Okay.
A lot of work.
That's all I have. Anything so else?
Just real quick, did they put that under the road, the conduit, or?
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah, it's a duct bank, and it's pretty large in size, and but we'll be working closely with everyone in town to make sure it's done quickly.
Question about poles.
Go ahead.
I was with Cliff Kistner, a member of this board, and he wanted to point out to me that all along Winter Street, the poles, they have utility wires hold them in place, and they're slack, and they're kind of all out of joint, and he was, well, I'm wondering what we could do about that. And I said, well, I don't know. And are you the person to ask, or is that Verizon?
I think it would be Verizon. The contact that I use is Lynn Stickney, who works directly with someone in the field. Mm-hmm. And sometimes, I know I get the question too, sometimes people will say poles are leaning or, you know, this and that. Sometimes they're actually set, you know, at an angle because of the topography, but they go out and someone will, you know, inspect, and they do regular inspections on the poles. So I think sometimes, you know, if in question, ask, but sometimes there are certain ways that they do set them. So,
okay. Yeah.
You mentioned a database for double poles. Is that only Eversource people that have access to that?
Those that have something attached to the wire are authorized to view it and to make updates.
Could you bring back to your people a question that perhaps cities and towns could have access to that on a governmental level? So that they could look and see if, in fact, some of these poles are on the list and maybe those
read
are
only.
Yeah, read only.
Read only access, something for the cities and towns to be able to watch and say, okay, so they are actually paying attention. It's just something to help the towns to go back to their own people who are going to call them and tell them, you know, what they're finding.
Yeah,
is that something you could bring back to your people, perhaps?
I certainly can, and the town would have access for owning any street lights or any communication wires on poles.
Mm-hmm. Okay. I think you've answered all our questions. Thank you very much for keeping us informed.
Thank you very much. Appreciate the opportunity.
It's a fun project.
Certainly is something a little unique, I guess.
Yeah,
it's not too many facilities being... Well, actually, lately there's quite a few facilities in the U.S. being built, but...
I only built one methane liquefier in my career and would fit an edge of this table. But I built some huge helium liquefiers.
Where did you work?
I worked Koch Industries and then Chart Industries.
Okay. Chart? Oh, okay.
17 years.
Oh, wow. Well, I didn't realize that. So actually, the cold box is coming from Chart?
I don't think the vendor's been finalized yet. But it's a
potential. There are many, many cold boxes.
Yeah.
Okay. They were one of our bidders, too. Well, they were the technology provider to one of our bidders.
Yep.
Well, thank you for the nice opportunity.
Thank you, Joy.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, guys.
Okay, we only have a couple things, and maybe we'll get out of here in another 5 minutes or so. Master plan follow-up. We've gotten the selectmen bought off on the implementation part of the plan for master plan. We have only data left required.
I just got an email from the Historical Commission at 8:30, so...
So
they're
so
all set.
Historic Commission, Michael and I talked today. Selectman Claire Wright had a couple of questions at her meeting on ones that had been assigned to the Historic Commission, the Historic Commission, and she thought they ought to be assigned to the Planning Board. Michael, the chairman of the Historic Commission, and I talked about it, and he felt that the focus should be coming from his board and not ours, so I didn't take them on. The ones that we would work with them if they were implementing a zoning bylaw that helped them get through that. But basically, and he also mentioned that part of our process that we've changed in the last couple of years is that the Historic Commission gets copies of all subdivision plans early on so that they know whether or not it might impact one of their deals.
Mm-hmm. Give them a sheet. Give them a sheet. There's all the future ones
on it. Yeah, I won't say it's all of them because they come out of the woods, literally. Parks and Rec is the only one left, so I'm hoping that we'll have that by our next meeting or so. And if we have that, then we can vote and publish formally the master plan that we've worked so hard and long on. I've already talked a little bit about the Legacy Farms road update. We'll take this opportunity one more time for everyone to come. Bring your scissors.
And, BYOS.
A whole bunch of grown-up scissors.
And we'll be running.
Yeah. Running with scissors.
Well, maybe some members of the planning board need to get the blunted ones.
I think that's a good idea.
Let's see. Does anyone have any comments, liaison reports, future agenda items? I'm looking around. I don't see anything.
No.
Correspondence. I think we just saw a couple of zoning board opinions that you got, decisions. Look for a motion to adjourn.
So moved.
Seconded. How do you vote on adjournment?
Aye.
Meeting is adjourned. Thank you very much.
As a reminder, Chief. Meeting at HQM on April 12th.
Wednesday, right?
Wednesday.
It's a Wednesday, and it's at HQM.
At the address?
No one left.